ज्ञानानन्दरसानुभूति सहित स्मेर प्रसन्नाननम् पूर्णेन्दुप्रभमात्मबोधनिलयम् शान्तम् निरीहम् परम् नित्यानित्यविचारसारचतुरम् निर्मत्सरम् पावनम् श्रीभूमानन्दमहं नतोऽस्मि कलितानन्दम् परम् श्रेयसे.
If I have read many times about it, but I honestly experienced what it means to be joyfully full. In all my years, I had never felt, because there was a complete fullness about the way Swamiji was sitting with us, explaining things. He told me, of course, one day he told me, Ashok, you must realize this is not a coffee table book. I said, Swamiji, I do realize, because this is happening all over tea. It is not happening over coffee. This book is happening over lots of... And Purnima here is a great tea lover. So every now and then she'll say, Swamiji, chai ho jai. Swamiji, chai ho jai. And when I was also going to the ashram, and after lunch between 12 and 3, by the time the 3 o'clock gong for tea comes, Swamiji would already see, I think Ashok needs some tea now. So obviously this is not a coffee table book. But jokes apart, that one day Swamiji spoke to me about, he said, Ashok, you have to, don't look at it as a coffee table book. This is not what it is. It's not a book. And I understood that day what he really meant. It just filled us. And I read all the text. And Swamiji said, just think about Pujya Swamiji. Everything will unfold. And everything happened like that. We were working, like you said, for hours and hours together. But we were full of energy, full of joy. And in spite of all the depletion of energy due to 12 hours, 14 hours, 16 hours, we were again full. So there was no way, no fullness was being taken away, and it was still full. And we really experienced, bringing out this book has been literally a glimpse of what sadhana is, a glimpse of what Swamiji has always spoken about, shunning likes and dislikes and rising above that and just doing what one has to do and allow things to unfold. And I think through this opportunity that we got to work with Ma Guru and Pujya Swamiji and Nutan Swamiji, we learned, we got a glimpse of what is sadhana, of what is the meaning of Pujya Swamiji's entire life. And I am forever indebted. My humble prostrations to all of you. I cannot express enough the work, hard work, dedicated effort of Purnima in bringing out this book. Towards the end of the book, when the book was actually over, Swamiji wrote a mail. He wrote a mail saying, Dear Purnima and Ashok, or is it Ashok and Purnima? And then I told him always, Swamiji, it is always Purnima and Ashok, because it is only if Purnima's effort is there, then Ashok appears. So it is always Purnima and Ashok. And she has stood... The effort that she has put into this book, the patience, the love and dedication with which she has worked with everybody is simply amazing. So heartfelt thanks to her also. Thank you. Jai Guru.
Nutan Swamiji has asked us to share with you that after Ashokji managed to make me stop sending corrections, then Purnimaji started sending corrections from there, telling Nutan Swamiji that I think this photograph is not clear enough. Do you have a better one? They printed the cover 3 times because they were not satisfied with shadows falling on Pujya Swamiji's face. Some forms they changed 2 or 3 times. Some photographs they asked us to replace. And that's when we really felt that this is a book we don't have to worry what is going to happen during the print. Ashok ji shared with us very emotionally. I think it has been an emotional journey for all of us. And now I think we would be requesting Pujya Swamiji for his message to us on this occasion.
Yam Shaiva Samupasade Shivaidi Brahmedi Vedantino Baudha Buddhaidi Pramana Padavaha Karte Dinayayika Arhan Nityatha Jaina Shasanarada Karmedi Mimamsaka Soyambo Vidadhadu Vanchita Phalam Trailokyanatho Harihi Madhiya Hridaya Kashe Sadanandamayo Guruhu Udedu Satatam Samyak Ajnana Timirarunaha Harihi Harihi, Harihi, Om Tatsat. As usual, we shall have 3 times chorus recitation of Omkara. I would like all of you to have a mental framework by virtue of which you will expand your mind covering the entire globe. Let the chorus recitation permeate the whole universe, bringing its benedictory influence in order to ensure the welfare of all creatures and beings in the world. With this kind of an expansion, join me. Sit comfortably erect, interlock your fingers and put them on your lap. Close your eyes, open the mouth and the heart and join me. Harihi, Harihi. Every one of you should participate in it, considering it to be a great opportunity and blessing. Harihi. Wondering what I should talk, and I will talk, but I shall talk. The first point that I would like to tell you is, this occasion is something very, very strange. Normally, on an occasion like this, I would not have been here. Generally, a book like this is written by a disciple or somebody who is close to a Mahatma. After long years of association, it is not easy. It's something very, very rare. And by the time anybody thinks of writing, and the writing materializes and finally it is published, the person about whom it is written, he would have dropped his body. But it has not happened. So I believe this is something very, very strange for me. But my life has been noted for many exceptional and out of ordinary developments. One point suddenly comes to my mind. After leaving my job in Calcutta, taking the necessary permission and parting from my Gurudev, after having shaved my face, put on a kind of a cloth like this, when I left Calcutta, one of my brothers asked me, "What are you going to do?" "I am going to our family, our house first. As a sannyasin, are you going back to your house? Why? I want to make sure that our parents and the others do not have any anxiety about their last child who has taken up sannyasa. They should not feel any sense of loss about me. So I will go home and be there for a while and then start my parivrajaka life, I said. My brother was stunned when he heard it. And I did it, my dear souls. Like this, there were many instances in my life where I have always taken an out-of-ordinary attitude and insight. And always I have found that whatever I felt and whatever I wanted to do had complete scriptural sanction, exhortation, permission and corroboration. I always say I am an atyashrami. I also say I am a nishkinchana and an akinchana. I appear before you as a sannyasin. I am. I was. I embrace the sannyasa. But as a sannyasin, the sannyasins also have got some rules, regulations, practices, observances, etc. If you ask me, I don't conform to them at all. But I carry the spirit and purpose of sannyasa, which is defined in Bhagavad Gita, which is defined in the Upanishads, which is devotionally elaborated in Srimad Bhagavatam. In all these scriptures, a direct exposure to which I have been able to gain after my diksha in the hands of my Gurudev and whatever he told me. The first thing I told him is, Baba, please don't ask me to read any books. I have come to you to get initiated. And after initiation, I will plunge into the sadhana process, the kriya that you are going to give me. And it is by a process of realization and experience that I want to get at the truth, if at all. So don't stop me by saying, read books. He said, absolutely all right. So I was very happy and relieved. But he also added, when you are supposed to read a book, it will come to your table, then you will feel like reading. Exactly the same thing happened. Mundakopanishad and Aparoksha Anubhuti were the two Sanskrit texts that somehow found their entry into my table. I started reading the book. When I started reading the book, I always say, it was something like on the new moon day, 1,000 full moons arising in the sky. This is the way I have found scriptural reading and exposure. Even now I am writing in our small journal, which has become very important, national and international, Vichara Sethu, The Path of Introspection. The leading article is on the science of inner redemption. It is a condensed version of the last prakarana of Yoga Vasishtha Ramayana, about which many people do not know and nobody writes about it. And whenever I am writing and evaluating and presenting the thought process there, I simply feel elevated. Just imagine the level of intelligence, the level of inner superb dimensions our people, ascetic people, austere people, were able to rise to, capture, and articulate so beautifully in an immortal manner. When were these written? Millennia ago. Even after so many thousands and thousands of years, the same language dances before the reader even today. Without a change of syllable, no hraswa has become dirgha. Everything remains the same. A language generally changes over 100 or 200 years. But here is a wonderful language of India for which a beautiful grammar was made and the whole language was locked, so to say, safely, that we were able to do nothing about it. It still continues to be a pristine language, a sovereign language, before which we only have to bend our head and absorb through our hearts. The message is like that. I would like every one of you to read that article, Science of Inner Redemption. You will know what is the power, the potential, and the sovereignty the Indian intelligence has in it as an intrinsic quality, majesty and magnificence. It is not something very simple. If our people are going to United States for the intelligence they have, it is not the intelligence that they have earned in their life. It has been bequeathed to them by their forefathers, you should understand. Your intelligence is not yours. You haven't done anything to acquire it. Not even to develop it, I should say. Any kind of an intellectual, I would like to say intelligential development, is a subjective inner personal development. It can only be done through subjective processes. That is what we call austerity, ascetic life. It has got something very great to offer to man. So normally, this kind of a book will be written by a disciple after so many years. In all probability, after about whom he writes, that person would have dropped his body and he would not be there to see the publication or come for an occasion like this. So I consider it to be extremely strange, strange and strange indeed. But in my life, many such strange developments have happened. Normally, I would not have been there and I should not be here also. But I am a free person, so I have no harm in coming here. Along with my disciples, I can go. I go wherever they want me, like an Alsatian dog. Our ascetic life is always for a kind of a spiritual inward fullness, abundance, and fulfillment. Any earnest seeker, if he is really seeking, he has to embrace asceticism at one point of time. There is no escaping the fact. Do you know our tradition speaks about four ashramas? Brahmacharya, Garhasthya, Vanaprastha and Sannyasa. All the four are meant for all people. But all of you householders, after your children become old, you start claiming, I am a very good householder. I have given birth to two or three children. I have educated them, got them married, sent them away married, etc., etc., and you are full. My dear souls, you are not full. You are a big minus. You have not been able to leave your family, leave your delusional clinging, and you have not been able to take up sannyasa to climax your purpose of human life. Our Rajarshis, particularly the kings belonging to the Ikshvaku dynasty, Kalidasa has clearly described Shaisave Bhyasta Vidyanam Yavane Vishayeshinam Vardhage Munivrittinam Yogayanande Tanutyajam. This is how he has described the kings. They were on the throne. Initially they studied. Later on they ruled. Thereafter they left. And finally in yoga, absorption, they left the body. This is the lifestyle meant for us. So if you go on clinging to your house and you happen to die on the cot of the family, I don't consider you to be having human fulfillment at all. So the ascetic life is the core of human life. So I was a seeker of truth. I started doing my austerity, my sadhana, after getting initiated by my Gurudev. And when I started getting exposed to the scriptures on the one hand, my own realizational background on the other, I found that I had to quit. I quit. Thereafter, I was greeted by the streets of India and graced by Providence. 62 years have passed. When I embraced sannyasa, it was apparently 23 years. Shall I tell you an anecdote? Would you like to hear? So I don't remember the years, etc., of these events. So I was saying 62 years. So I was wondering, am I right? How to know about it? I don't know. So a few weeks back, a family came to our ashram. The youngster is working in America. He and his wife, along with a child, wife's mother and mother's elder sister. So after I spent a little time, the elderly lady came to me and said, Swamiji, I heard you in Trichur talking from the bottom of a, from the bed of a platform tree called Srimulasthanam. I was studying in the second class and I was 7 years old. Are? 7 years old, studying in the second class. My father brought me there and you are speaking from. That was the first talk I gave in the first days. Then I asked, what is your age now? 69 years old, she said. I was so happy. My 62-year reference is correct. She was 7 years old. When he spoke to me, she was 69. So naturally, it is 62 years. So I had a sigh of relief. I am not speaking untruth. In this way, everything is happening in my life. So I am very, very happy. In the whole of the Vedas, which are the fundamental, primary and supreme literature, there is one statement which you should understand. Brahmavidu apnodi param. The one who knows Brahman, the supreme reality, attains the supreme. This is the message of our Vedas. Brahmavidu apnodi param. My dear souls, our Narayanashrama Tapodanam, which I founded, this has this Brahmavidu apnodi param as the motto. And our emblem also is indicating it. Guru Diksha and Guru Sangha are extremely important. I had Diksha from my Guru, but I also had Sangha with him. Sangha means association. Whenever it was possible, I used to take leave and go spend 2 or 3 days. He used to come to Calcutta also. Like that, Guru Sangha and Guru Diksha. Everything took place rather fast. I started reading biographies, particularly of Ramakrishna Dev, Sharada Devi, then Swami Vivekananda. All the 8 volumes about him he has written, that also I read, and other biographies also. So I was having the scriptural exhortation and call saying that Yatihi Yadrichiko Bhaved, become an ascetic and depend on chance. This was the call. And that call, there was no question of heeding or not heeding. I simply left, very happy. My Gurudev was there in Calcutta when I did this. 62 years have passed. All the 62 years, I have been a moving university, giving lectures in different parts of India and also abroad. Anybody can take admission. Children also hear me. Elderly people also hear me. They also come near me. 31 years passed. After 31 years, Nutun Swamiji and Ma came to our ashram and joined me. Now, they have been in the ashram for the past 31 years. So the book that you have here, A Great Association, My Dear Souls, is an outcome of 32 years of ascetic and austere life of enlightenment led by Nutun Swamiji. If he was not an ascetic and he was not given to renunciation, I don't think he would have been close to me. He has been close is not the right word. They have had an opportunity to know me inside and outside. When I was in the hospital, they were by my side looking after me. In the ashram, Ma looks after me. She keeps my health very well, I believe. That is why even 86 years I am continuing. I am very brisk. I take dandal 35 times. This kriya I take 550 times a day. Many things I do. Only because my health is looked after. Many sannyasins are not able to look after their health. So I am fortunate in that sense. So 31 years of life of observation, life of research, he was already given to research. That research-oriented study and application, 31 years after that he has written this book. Now 131, another 31, then another 24. That is how I am 86 now. They have had ample exposure to this austere life. This exposure would not have been possible if Swamiji and Ma themselves did not take to ascetic life. It will be a misnomer to think that I know my Gurudev, especially an ascetic Gurudev living in an ashram and then write a book It is impossible. It will never be a fair account. What takes place between a guru and Shishya throughout is knowledge, knowledge, and knowledge. What is this knowledge? This is called the subject knowledge. All the other knowledge that you have in the academic field, right from the pre-kindergarten stage to post-doctorate research, everything is object knowledge. Things which the senses perceive and interact with. This is something inside the body. Inside the body, what are there? The mind is there, the intelligence is there, the ego is there. Every one of you has a mind. You say, I have a mind. But I wonder whether you anything about mind. You don't know even M. Not to speak of M-I-N-D. What is this mind? It is not a part of the body. It is associated with the body. You go to a hilltop and take a grand look around. What would be the magnitude, the infinite variety and the infinite distances which through the eyes you would have covered? How do you know that you have seen this? The whole picture is imprinted by your mind, in the mind, within the body. It is not like a camera photographing. Certainly not. If I say 10 square mile of distance, then the 10 square mile is imprinted by my mind. When I look into the sea, a lot of expanse is imprinted here. So the entire world is a mind's imprint. So tell me, what is the capacity of your mind? What is the potential and possibility of your mind? This is what we are getting exposed to in the hands of spirituality. It is a complete subject exposure. Exposure into the subject. It is not dealing with the seen or the visible. It is dealing with the seer, the seer, the witness, the seer, the thinker, the understander, the discoverer, the forgetter, and the memorizer. Now, how can this knowledge be available from a book? So you will have to have very close association with the guru. He will speak any time to you. When I had my interactions with my guru, I was never formal at all. Whenever he spoke, I heard. He may speak while sipping tea. He may speak some other time. Anytime I wanted to ask, I asked also. So that close association is very, very important. As I told you, normally, I would not have been here at all. Nobody gets an opportunity. First of all, the body has to live. And somebody has to become a disciple, an ascetic disciple, living close by, observing closely all the 24 hours, so to say, and then develop an insight. To know God is to become God. In the introductory note which I have written, it is not an introduction to the book. It is actually an introduction. That too, one day I closed my computer and I was going to bed at 12 o'clock night. Swamiji came to my office room and said, you have to write an introduction. Oh, do I have to? And then he went back. So I opened my computer. Immediately started, my fingers started moving. I wrote the introduction which you read there. I had written one important point, which he has removed. I said, I have not read this book, nor is it necessary to read. Because we were supposed to be in America when the final print was supposed to be given. At that time, I would not have been there. And he had not written his two chapters. So where was the question of my reading? And what will be the matter he writes, that I already know. And I am not going to comment upon the content of the book. I will write something, whatever I feel. It need not be even related to the book. We only have one subject to talk. Swamiji can talk only on one subject. I also can talk only on one subject. And what is that? The self. What? The subject dimension, the subject magnitude, the subject magnificence. You know, we have in Disha Channel, a telecast program, 5 days in a week. It is named Inner Spiritual Splendor. What? Inner Spiritual Splendor. That is what we have to talk about. So why should I read the book? And it was serialized in Vijaya Sethu also. So I wrote, if you ask me who I am, I am a Guru Bhakta. What? Say that. Guru Bhakta. I am a devotee of my Gurudev.